just going to make a quick announcement. As people are coming in, there's might be some chairs in your row. If you wouldn't mind just squeezing in.
Wisdom.
Jesus' name. Bless you, Lord. You may be seated.
But there it is again. I always wonder what to say on Saturday night on Easter, like Happy Easter Eve. I don't know what you say. But boy, what a glorious time. Hello. I mean, this is the reason we do this, people. 52 weeks a year is because Jesus is not in a tomb somewhere. He's alive, man. And we celebrate Easter every time we come together because He is the manifested risen Lord that has changed a lot of people's lives. And that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. Easter means a chance for change. Easter means a chance for change. And you don't have to stay the same. Isn't that good news? Doesn't matter if you know the Lord tonight or if you don't know the Lord. The question is, you can change. Easter is all about change. There are changes in the season. I love the springtime. I love to see flowers come back alive. You know, and don't take this too far, guys. I'm still a guy, but I have really gotten into flowers. And, you know, I'm the one that's going to Cheryl now and saying, can we go get flowers? You know, and it's like a new life for me. I know it's hot in here. And Joel, if you're still here, turn on the air conditioning, please. But I just love springtime. I love I'm taking my walk today and I walk by the Little League Park and all the kids are out there playing Little League, you know, and people are doing all sorts of things. They're going places, you know, it's like the planet is coming alive, you know, and I get all of these things that start going through my mind, you know, like things I would like to do. I mean, cabin fever takes a really huge hit during this time of the year. I like to think about things I like to play with, you know, and my wife says that doesn't just take springtime, it's all the time, you know, but I'm thinking about motorcycles. Amen, guys, come on. Yeah, amen, amen. You know, and I'm thinking about all sorts of stuff, and it's just because there's a change that is coming. Well, let me tell you about this Jesus that we're talking about tonight. This Jesus came to the planet because He wanted to change people's lives. People were going in the wrong direction. Jesus came to change our lives, to say that's not the way we should be going. We should be going this way. And so He comes to the planet. And actually, every one of us in here have been affected, whether you agree with it or not, by that person, Jesus, that came here to the planet some 2,000 years ago. When you write out the date tonight or today on one of your checks, or you look at the date, it's April 19th, 2003 AD. What is that? After the death of our Lord, 2,003 years ago. And if you want to look at it backwards, people look at it from the time of His birth backwards as B.C., before Christ, and we measure it. So this person, Jesus, that came to the planet, that claimed to be God, has had a credible impact upon our lives. He changes lives. He changes our lives. Often, you and I, when we find ourselves in difficult situations, we find certain attitudes and actions that come up that lots of times are very discouraging. Have you ever been just absolutely, you know, discouraged with yourself? Like, oh, man, I shouldn't have acted that way. Or, you know, and really what happens to us lots of times in difficult times, we really discover attitudes and things that come up in our life and we see it and we just go, I thought I was over that. I thought I didn't have to deal with that anymore. But there it is again. And so through discouraging times, we have manifestations of things that we don't like and habits that we have that should be changed. And so it's all about change. And yet we find ourselves we're not able to change. Other times, things are really going well in our life. I mean, it's just on top of it. And blessings are coming to our life. And then we discover attitudes even in the good times that are displeasing to us. That's one of the phenomena that I find out about Christians, just about people in general, is that people are really going through hard times and people that are going through really good times ask the same question, what's life all about? It's just amazing to me. And then there's some of us here that are tonight that are not going through either phase and we think, hey, life is going pretty well. And that's a pretty good place to be in, only to recognize that it doesn't stay there, does it? Something comes into our life, and then we begin to discover this is not a good deal either. Then we realize, when we start looking at all these problems, that what we're going through, is that most of the time we turn to something that's going to try and help us change. Sometimes that can be self-help programs. It can be self-help books. We can buy tapes, whatever it might be. And then we start this whole process of, I'm really going to change myself, only to find out that we don't have the energy to sustain that change. Most of the time when we start something, we stop simply because we don't, it's not because we don't want to, it's simply because we don't have the inner strength to really sustain the change that we want to go through. And so we kind of get this defeatism that goes on. As a matter of fact, a lot of the gyms around town or the self-help or the fitness centers around town know that when people sign up at the first of the year, that by Valentine's Day, 80% of them will not be going back to the gym. Because they know that they can't sustain it. They want to start that way, but then they, hey, am I connecting tonight with you? I mean, it's like this change that we want to do, and it just doesn't happen. And then some of you are here tonight, and you don't come to church all this often, and you now here's Pastor Dan standing up here saying, you can change. And you're going, man, first of all, I'm not even religious. You know, I don't even know if Jesus likes me, let alone if he can change me. And what we really do is we start dealing with, and this is not just to the person that is a non-religious person. And by the way, lots of times when we use the word religion, to us in the church, that's a really negative tone. But to a lot of people out in the world, it's a very positive tone when they say to you, I see you're a very religious person. But they don't look at themselves as though they are a religious person. And so they really wonder, well, what in the world does this Jesus really have to do with me? Because simply, I am not a religious person. Well, let me give you some really good news tonight. Jesus did not come to religious people. He came to broken people. He came to people that said, I need help. He came and said, you know, if you really want to change your life, you can, and I have the power to change your life. You know, when we go back to this whole idea of the third category that I really talked about tonight, about some of us that are just really at a place where life is really going good. And you wonder, I really don't have any need to change. I feel like things are going pretty well in my life. Why would I want to change? And I'm going to tell you why. Because life could be so much better with God. You're only scratching the surface of the potential that God has for your life if you'd recognize, if I would just open my heart, if I would just open my mind, if I would just open my life to the Lord, that he really does have the ability to change our lives. You know that you couldn't go this Easter weekend without Pastor Dan talking about golf. It's one of those other things that are in the air, you know, golf. There's a guy by the name of Tiger Woods. How many of you have heard of Tiger Woods? Tiger Woods, when he first came onto the pro circuit in 1996, I believe it was, won four tournaments. One of those was a major. They call it the Masters. And in his freshman year on the tour, he won it. That year, his earnings were $2 million. That was only a scratching the surface of what his endorsements were. They were $60 million. So in his first year, this young man made $62 million. I'm impressed. Calls his coach up at the end of the year and says, Coach, I know that I can do better. I want to change my swing. And see, most of us would go, why? I mean, wouldn't you ask that question? Why? Maybe some of us wouldn't. I don't know. But I would. I would say, why? I mean, you're on top of the game. He changed his swing only the next year to win one tournament, but the following year to come back and win six and set records that nobody else even came close to. Why did he do that? I'll tell you why. It's because he knew he could do better. See, and some of us are just, and just take this for what it's worth tonight. Many people in America are in the status quo. I'm just kind of satisfied with my life. And in my opinion, the toughest people to reach in the American culture are those that everything's going quite well. Because why do I need anything? Because it could be so much better with Jesus. We're going to talk about a guy tonight, Zacchaeus, who is a non-religious guy. He was at the top of his game. He was making more money than he'd ever made in his life, and yet Jesus came in and he saw a better life. And his life was absolutely changed, and that's what we want to talk about. Opening our lives to change at a time of Easter. Luke 19, verse 1, says this, "And Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. And a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector." In other words, he was raking in the dough and was wealthy. He wanted to see Jesus, who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed up in a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. And when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zac, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down and at once welcomed him gladly. And all the people saw this and began to mutter, "Pharisees and Sadducees, the same yesterday, today, and forever." You can take that any way you want to. "And he was gone. He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anyone or anybody out of anything, I will pay them back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation came to his house," or to this house, "because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost." Let me just say this to you before I go on with my 5 points tonight. Number one is this. The God that we serve is a God that seeks after people. He wants relationship with people, and he seeks after them. It's the only God in all of the world that seeks after people. If you have your little outlines you want to follow along, let's take a look at 5 suggestions that open us up to change. 5 suggestions that open us up to change. Thank you. I hear, feel the air conditioning, don't you? Amen. We did pay our bill last month, so we've got it. Number one is this: beware of increased levels of activity when we encounter Jesus. Beware of increased levels of activity when we encounter Jesus. Verse 1, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. The city, now look at this city. Here's Jesus. And I really want you to get a hold of this tonight. I really want you to see this. Jesus is not just another man. Jesus is God. And when he passes through, something stirred up in us. And I mean, there's a parade going on. People are talking about this. There's conversations. They want to see who Jesus is. It's not a small gathering of people. It's a large gathering of people because something is making an impression upon them. And see, what the sad part about this is that many of us tonight really wonder if this Jesus really passes by and does he really stir me like he did the people in Jericho? And I want to answer that question for you. He does. The sad fact of the matter is that many of us, because we have been so conditioned to the natural, that we don't recognize the spiritual when Jesus passes by. When God passes by, something on the inside of us begins to stir. And I want to give you 3 ways that it begins to stir. It's not in your notes. Number one is this: mentally. Something begins to happen in us mentally when Jesus, the risen Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit, passes by our life and we begin to think in new ways. See, many of us here tonight could be thinking of new ways about accountability. Why are these thoughts running through my mind that I need to be accountable with my life to somebody? See, and these are not original with you. You might think they are, but something is stirring you about the activity that is going on in your mind at this particular time. Other questions that might be coming up are ones about death. What's going to happen to me at death? And it seems to be that when that stirring starts taking place, people begin to become interested in a lot of spiritual answers to those kind of questions. And so they want to explore Christianity. They want to explore spiritualism of some sort because they want to gain some kind of answers. That's an activity that is going on in your mind that Jesus Christ, none other than God himself, that knows you, has the ability to enter your life and begin to pass by, and activity begins to take place in your life. Number 2 is this: through your emotions. One of the ways that God really stirs us, and we just need to recognize this, one of the ways that God really stirs us is that we begin to feel differently about situations that we find ourselves in. Lots of times we go by somebody on the road or at the office or whatever the case might be, and they're going through a difficult time, and all of a sudden on the inside of you, something begins to turn, and you start to feel about this person like somebody you've never felt about before, and there's like a compassion that starts coming out of you. And as a matter of fact, some of we guys even think, I might be turning into a wimp at this particular time because I'm starting to get, you know, a frog in my throat when I think about these things and I can't quite figure out what's going on. Jesus is passing by and he's stirring your emotions. And by the way, it's not just on the soft side of things, it's also on the just side of things. When we see injustice and things that didn't really bother us before now begin to bother us. And we wonder, why in the world am I so shaken about this particular situation when it didn't bother me at all before? And the reason why is Jesus is passing by and there's a stirring that's going on just like it was in Jericho. And then the number three is this, your will. We begin to make choices. And first of all, I want to applaud those of you that are honoring the Lord at this particular time because Easter is really for the non-religious person. Thanks for coming. And the point of it is that now we find ourselves starting to make decisions and our lifestyle is beginning to change a little bit simply because our will now is saying, you know, there's something more to life than just me finding fun somewhere. And something begins to draw us in. Now, if you take those three entities and kind of draw a circle around them, that is your spirit. That is you. You cannot separate your physical being from your spirit too far, and you can't overanalyze it because if you separate it too far, that is death. And so all that is combined in your physical being and something begins to happen and you start having feelings and you begin to wonder what in the world is going on, and I'll tell you exactly what's going on. Jesus is passing by and he's stirring your heart. Activity is going on. And all I'm saying to you, it is not an uncommon thing for people to begin to wonder, why am I so concerned about things that I didn't used to be concerned about? And it's because Jesus, listen to this, has your address. He knows where you live. He knows where you work. He knows where you sleep. And he just loves to bug people about himself. See? So he comes in. Number two is this. Curiosity may signal a desire for change. Verse 3. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. Number two, curiosity may signal a desire for change. Watch out for curiosity, loved ones. I mean, it is huge. That word curiosity is really a curious word. Curiosity. What happened to Moses? Moses is on the backside of the desert for 40 years. He sees a burning bush, but it is not being burned up. And so he turns aside and he becomes curious. And because he becomes curious, it changes his life forever. Now, let me just say this to you. People, it's not only on the good side that we can become curious. We can also become curious about the dark side. And it's just, where are we going to feed our appetites? What are we going to look at? But people that become curious, there's something that is going on the inside because people that are curious don't care about things that don't change their life. They just pass them by. They don't even know that they're there. But they become curious about it. Samuel became curious, little Samuel, about a voice that was speaking to him. He heard the voice. What happens, man? He starts hearing the voice. He runs into Eli. And those of you that would know the story understand that because of that curiosity, he raises himself, or God raises him, to a place that he becomes a judge and a well-known man that really leads Israel in a real revival of bringing them back towards the Lord because he became curious. Zacchaeus becomes curious about the Lord. Jesus comes by, and so he runs up in a tree and he sees him just because this thing that's going off in the inside. Let me say this to you. Change never, ever happens from the outside in. It always happens from the inside out. And when something is going off in the inside of us about a change in our life, it is because God is doing a work in our lives that we become curious about something. See, I watch these young guys, especially during this time of the year, and you go by the park or, you know, wherever they might be working out, and they rip their shirts off and they have a six-pack. You know what I'm talking about, you know? I realized years ago those kind of guys that have a six-pack have actually paid a price for it. Are you here tonight? I mean, they really do work to make their, sculpt themselves and make them, I bet you there's some visitors who are going, man, this guy is up there talking about a six-pack and it's Easter. What in the world is going on? Well, I know this, that those changes don't come easily, and the people that sculpt themselves have a desire to do it on the inside. And that's why I've decided to stay with my keg. Isn't that good? You know, I'd love to have one of those, but I am not going to pay the price for it. That's all there is to it. You know, there's too much work. So the idea of it is, and the understanding is that when we want change, when we become curious about enough, it begins to change us. Number three is this. Preconceived ideas concerning Jesus begin to change. Preconceived ideas concerning Jesus begin to change. Verse 6. So he came down at once and welcomed him. The Lord comes walking by, he looks up and says, Zacchaeus, come on down. I'm going to go to your house and have dinner. See? Now, I don't know about you, but according to the scriptures, there is nothing there to indicate that there was any kind of relationship with Jesus and Zacchaeus before this moment. None. And I am sure that in Zacchaeus' mind, there was a preconceived idea as to who Jesus was. He was curious about him, but he really didn't know who he was. As a matter of fact, years ago, B.C., that doesn't mean before Christ, it means before Cheryl. I had a conversation with somebody of the opposite sex, and she sat down with me, and she began to talk. And she said, you're so much different than what I thought you were. And that was a very pleasing conversation because she was talking about a good side of me. You see, she had a preconceived idea as to who I was until she actually sat down and began to talk to me and found out that what she had learned about me wasn't true. Jesus does an incredible thing. He looks up into the tree and just recognize this. Just hear it for what it is. Whether it's a word of knowledge, in other words, he got this word about who this guy was up here, or if he actually heard about the town of Jericho and about this guy by the name of Zacchaeus and then just recognized who he was. It really doesn't matter because when he said the words Zacchaeus, the personal touch, it changed his mind about who Jesus was. Loved ones, let me just say this to you. Jesus knows how to touch us in personal ways. You know what? Finding out and talking to a lot of people that call themselves unchurched or de-churched or they don't go to church a lot or non-religious, you know what they really say? I really like Jesus. Matter of fact, I don't have a problem with Jesus at all. I just don't like all the trappings and all the wrappings that he comes in. Because a lot of people really believe this, if I really give my life to Jesus, then someday I'm going to be sitting on a stage somewhere in a polyester suit, you know, shouting things that I don't want to shout. Doing things that I don't want to do because I'm going to become some kind of crazy fanatic. And I want you to know, it is a barrier to people today in our town, in River City, in Grand Junction, Colorado today, because they have an idea that they got off of, you know, Christian TV somewhere, that Jesus is going to turn me into some kind of a loony. And it's not true, people. It's not true. And through that personal contact, through Jesus just sitting down and having a hamburger, I don't know what they had. They just talked. Something happened in that conversation where Zacchaeus goes, man, you're just so different than what I heard about. And can I just say this to you, loved ones? Some of you here tonight that are really kind of searching, you're on your spiritual pilgrimage. Jesus is real. And he treats you real. He never asks you to do something that will make you look weird or different. All that. He comes on the inside to change us. And see, some of us really have preconceived ideas who God is. And if we don't change our mind, Jesus can never enter to change our lives. And all I'm asking you to do tonight is to consider this. If you have preconceived ideas about who Jesus is, put them down. Let him speak to you. Because he wants to draw you in. He wants to have a relationship with you. He does wonderful things in people's lives. Number four is this. The opinion of others has less effect upon us. The opinion of others has less effect upon us. Verse 7. And all the people began to see this and mutter. Isn't that an interesting word? Mutter. He has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Zacchaeus could have begun to wonder, what are the people going to think about me? Now think about this in Zacchaeus. Put yourself in Zacchaeus. He was already a rotten guy to the people that lived there in Jericho because he collected more taxes than what they should have been paying. So he knew that he was already hated. You know, when you deal with rejection in one particular arena, it's not real difficult to, you know, keep dealing in that arena with the rejection that's coming. But now, to deal with rejection, because now I'm, quote, I'm going to follow this guy, Jesus, he begins to think, what in the world are these people going to think now? Let me just stop and just say this. There are a lot of people today that are not following the Lord because of what Proverbs 29 says. The fear of man brings a snare. And let me just put it out to you as quickly and easily as I can. Most of it is media generated. When they put a Christian on TV sometimes, and God love them, they don't have any teeth. And they don't utter the most articulate position as to where we are as a church. And people just go, if that's what it is, I don't want any part of it. In other words, a lot of people, listen to this. The reason they don't want to become a Christian is because they think they have to kiss their brains goodbye. It's the truth. It's the truth. See? All you have to do is become a feeler. See? Just feel good, man. Doesn't matter what you're going through. Just feel good. And that's not what it's about at all. Jesus never asked anybody to throw their mind away. You know, is that you can really be a thinker. And that's one of the things that I love about the Scriptures, people. One of the things that I love about the Scriptures is to the simplest person it can challenge them, and to the most intellectual it can challenge them. You see? And it's the idea is that lots of times what happens to us is the fear of man brings a snare, and it's like, you know, if I become a Christian, what are all the people going to say? Well, let me ask you this question, because I actually do happen to believe that this is exactly what's going to happen. On the day of judgment, you are going to stand before an almighty God and give an account of the deeds that you've done in the flesh. And I want you to ask yourself this question, where are those people going to be that you had a fear of what they might say if you follow Jesus? They're not going to be anywhere around. Nowhere around. See, and loved ones, I am not pleading with anybody tonight. I am just asking you to really do a deep heart search of this thing. It is one of the reasons that you don't follow the Lord is simply because I'm afraid of what my colleagues might think if I become, quote, religious. You know, if I really begin to follow the Lord, what are they going to say? I'm going to tell you what they're going to say. You're weird. You know what? And that's just some of the things that you have to deal with. You don't have to buy into that. But they're going to say things. They're going to mutter. They're going to say things about you. But that is not the case with dear Zacchaeus. It's a man I've known for everything bad in all my life. The best thing I could probably be called is a Christian. You see, and it's just that idea is I'm going to deal. I'm not going to allow the fear of man to stop me from following what I know my heart is telling me is true. Number five is this. Remember that grace is something we receive. Remember that grace is something we received. Often what prevents people from committing to Christ is the kind of reception they think they will receive. Most people, when they come to the Lord and feel like they're going to get, you know, somebody that's going to chew them out, that's really going to get after them and give them a lecture as I told you so. But just the opposite is true of what the scriptures say. I usually don't read things, but I want to read this story to you tonight because it so captivates and so capsulizes exactly what we're saying tonight, is that we receive grace when we come to the Lord. Jenny grew up on a cherry orchard near Traverse City, Michigan. Her parents, a little old-fashioned, tended to overreact to her nose ring, her music, and the way she dressed. Anybody here? One night in an argument with her father, she screamed, "I hate you. I never want to see you again." And that night, she ran away, catching a bus to Detroit. The second day in Detroit, she met a man with the biggest car she had ever seen. He offered her a ride, brought her lunch, and gave her a place to stay. He even gave her some pills that made her feel better than she had ever felt in her life. The good life continued for about a year. That man, who she now called boss, taught her a few new things that men like, and since she was underage, men would pay a premium for her. She lived in a penthouse and ordered room service whenever she wanted. But after a year, she became ill, and her boss became mean. Interesting, huh? Soon, she was out on the streets without a penny to her name. The little bit of money she made turning tricks all went to support her habit. One freezing night on the street, sleepless and hungry, Jenny was overwhelmed with the longing to go back home, to be at the cherry orchards, the warm home and her golden retriever. Sobbing, she called her mom three times, only to get the answering machine. The third time, she said, "Mom, Dad, it's me. I want to come home. I'm catching the bus, and I'll get there about midnight tomorrow night at the station. If you're not there, I'll stay on the bus and go to Canada. On the 7-hour trip home, Jenny began to have doubts. What will I say? What will they think? Will they even show up? Will they even be there at the station? When the bus finally rolled into a small station, the driver announced, 15 minutes, folks. That's all the time we have here, 15 minutes. 15 minutes to decide her life. She nervously checked how she looked in the little compact mirror. As she walked into the terminal, nothing could have prepared her for what she saw. 40 people at midnight standing there, uncles and aunts and cousins and brothers and sisters and mom and dad and grandparents, all of them with silly party hats and blowing silly noisemakers, only families, huh? And holding banners, and a big banner that stretched the entire terminal that said, "Welcome home." As her eyes filled with tears, her dad lunged forward out of the crowd and grabbed her. She said, "Oh, Dad, I'm so sorry." Her dad said, "Shh, we don't have time for apologies. You're going to be late for the party. We've planned a banquet for you." People, Jesus exactly repeats that story with the prodigal son. The prodigal son thought he was coming home and he's going to get an angry father, and all he got was a big party. That's what heaven says. That's what the Bible talks about. All of heaven rejoices when somebody comes back home. And hear this about Zacchaeus. Hear this, people. If you forget everything else I say tonight, he did not discipline himself into changing. He did not do one thing. He changed because the grace of God he received, and it changed him. All people here tonight, Easter is a time of change. You don't have to stay the way you are. Open yourself to this living Jesus. Allow him to change our lives. Let's stand together. Bless you, Lord. I want to pray. Lord Jesus, first of all, we thank you for coming to this planet. Lord, we thank you that you're the God that sought us out. We weren't seeking you, but you sought us out. And I pray tonight, Lord, that as your Holy Spirit is upon this place and touching individuals, that tonight, Lord, individuals would open their hearts and their minds to the grace of yourself, recognizing that you're a God that has the ability to change us from the inside, that we don't have to discipline ourselves into something, that we can actually receive the grace and the mercy that we've sang about this evening. We can actually receive in the person of yourself, Jesus, the grace and the mercy that actually changes us and makes us into something that is brand new. And so I ask tonight, Lord, as we close with this song, that those here tonight that are really meaning business with you, Lord, would do business in a personal way and saying, Jesus, I really want to know you. I really want to know you in the way that Zacchaeus knew you. I really want to know you in the way in the lives that I see around me. I really want to change. And no greater time, loved ones, than at Easter to allow that change to take place. We're going to worship the Lord together. And as we worship the Lord, I want you to do business with God. I just want you to say words from your heart to God. Invite Him in and ask that change to take place. Let's worship the Lord. You do business with God.
Would you bow once more with me?